In the late 1940s and early 1950s, a new movement was growing in the jazz world, one that contrasted heavily with the most pervasive subgenre of the time, bebop. This movement came to be known as cool jazz, also known as the cool school, and was characterized by more relaxed tempos, softer dynamics, and a generally more subdued approach than bebop. Perhaps the biggest star early on in the new style's development was Miles Davis, with his record Birth of the Cool, which was a perfect blend of gorgeous arranging done by Gil Evans, great writing, and a more commercial appeal than most other jazz records at the time. While Miles, and later Chet Baker and Dave Brubeck, to name a few, were champions of this sound, perhaps the figure most responsible in terms of pure influence was Lennie Tristano, a brilliant virtuoso pianist who had been tinkering and experimenting with many of the elements that would come to define cool jazz for much of his career. Interestingly, Tristano's music and pedagogy, which went on to inspire the relatively commercially popular style of cool jazz, was largely born out of a mixture of elements from bebop and the avant-garde, from which he hoped to achieve quote-unquote pure improvisation. From the bebop school, Tristano took the idea of the running eighth note line, a notion that became the basis of most of his improvisations and came to characterize his sound and approach. Two recordings that exemplify this commitment are Line Up and East 32nd from Lennie Tristano / The New Tristano. These two tracks can tell us a lot about his general approach, philosophy, and preferred aesthetic, from which we can see his clear influence on the aforementioned cool school. The first thing that stands out, at least to me, is that when Tristano solos, it really is the Tristano show, so to speak. According to various reports from himself and fellow musicians, he preferred an almost metronomic and relatively static rhythm section, as he felt it allowed him to be able to fully focus on the purity of his lines and phrases. This is obviously borne out in the aforementioned recordings. The drummer is essentially just playing the ride cymbal, for the most part not even clicking the hi-hat on 2 or 4, and only on the rarest of occasions doing anything with the left hand, like comping with the snare, for instance. The critic Barry Ulanov made the very accurate assessment that the drummer was not so much playing a fixed measure of 4 quarter notes, but the bar as a continuity of beats, sort of 1-1-1-1-1-1, etc., without any bar line restrictions. This is really helpful in terms of understanding the intent behind this music, as initially it's easy to think that maybe the drummers of Tristano simply weren't good listeners, or didn't have good chemistry, or something of that nature. But it's clear that Tristano preferred this style of accompaniment, as it allowed him more freedom to break outside of the typical phrasing of 4 or 8 bars. And on these recordings, he plays over the bar line frequently and in a way that gives the music a floaty quality and a sense of constant forward thrust. This was a moment of epiphany for me, as the term I have often characterized the feel of cool jazz as is floaty, and this discovery about Tristano's preferred time feel gave me some insight as to why that is. By the time the Tristano time feel had come to influence many of the records that come to mind when thinking about cool jazz, it had become much less literal than in these early iterations on recordings like the new Tristano, but remained a clear descendant sonically. On many popular cool albums, the drummer isn't fully restricted from comping, interacting, or playing with the whole kit. However, when compared to the music of Charlie Parker, Bud Powell, Dizzy Gillespie, and others around the same era, there is a considerable disparity in terms of the drummer's role. Whereas bebop often feels like a spirited conversation between several musicians, with the soloist leading the charge and doing most of the talking, much of cool jazz tends to favor a lecture where one speaks and everyone else listens and provides the necessary support while not interrupting in too major of a way. There may be some negative connotation to the word lecture there, but it was not intended as anything derogatory, just meant to demonstrate the dynamic present in the cool school when contrasted with its more outwardly expressive counterpart. Similarly to the drums, Tristano sought out bass playing that would provide the steady, stable environment that he felt he needed, eventually resorting to playing left-hand bass lines on some recordings. In fact, Lee Konitz recalled a story wherein the great bassist of John Coltrane Quartet fame, Jimmy Garrison, came to do a session with Tristano. Tristano apparently put a metronome in front of Garrison, who fairly justifiably took this as an insult. It would seem Tristano simply wanted a bass player to play in time to a degree that was very precise and calculated, right on the beat, perfectly even. This is really striking when placed in comparison to the bebop school, who would view using a metronome as a sign of weak time, lack of ability to swing, something of that nature, and also encourage certain personal liberties in the music, such as stretching the time or laying back. Many of these differences that would become apparent between Tristano's approach and that of the bebop musicians would go on to lay some of the groundwork for cool jazz. For instance, cool jazz tended to have an emphasis on smoothness, particularly in terms of timbre and rhythm. We can see Tristano's influence clearly, as he always required that his rhythm section play with as much clarity and consistency as possible. Remember the aforementioned example with Jimmy Garrison. Another way his influence manifests is through his use of an almost classical conception and technique when improvising. Cool jazz was more closely tied to classical music than almost any genre up to that point, aside from third string music, and it is evident that Tristano's piano technique and compositional preferences draw upon European music as well. He developed his piano playing through the practice of classical music and was thought to be prodigious as a young child. And for his composing, one need only listen to this composition, Wow, featuring Lee Konitz and War Marsh, to hear that it sounds very classical-esque in terms of the structure and angles of the phrases, as well as the virtuosity required to get through such a heady melody. His influence on the cool is found in Konitz and Marsh as well, both of whom had more to do with the movement of cool music than Tristano himself. Famously, Konitz was a member of the Nonette that produced Miles Davis's Birth of the Cool and was a featured soloist at several points next to Jerry Mulligan, another figure primarily associated with cool jazz. This leads me to my next point, which is how far-reaching the influence of Lennie Tristano has become. As I mentioned before, Lee Konitz in particular would go on to become quite a star in the mainstream jazz world, controversially beating Charlie Parker for a downbeat Best Saxophonist Award. Though, to be fair, I can't imagine politics and race didn't play a role in this at the time. Konitz went on to influence a great many musicians and altoists alike. I know for sure that current stars Jaleel Shah and Ben Van Gelder have listed Konitz as a big influence, and it is certainly very noticeable in some early recordings of Van Gelder's that can be found on YouTube. As far as the tenor sax goes, Warren Marsh, Tristano's lesser-known but equally talented student, went on to have a big influence, in particular, on modern tenor player Mark Turner. Turner was a premier player in the early 2000s and is still very active today, though he has already left a legacy and sphere of influence of his own. A student of Turner's who has recently come into her own over the past decade is Melissa Aldana, who cites her teacher, and further back, Warren Marsh, as heavy inspirations. This all goes back to Lennie, seemingly, who, aside from being an extraordinary player, really made most of his living by teaching, and at a certain point abandoned recording and performing almost altogether in favor of quietly running his teaching studio. Tristano is one of the first performers and teachers in jazz history, one of the first people that really combined the two, and is actually the first person that I could really find an example of that was known pretty equally for both. This has become the standard in today's jazz and music world in general, and it's highly uncommon for a professional musician to not at least have a small studio, teach at a university, etc. Whether that has been because of the decreased demand for live jazz music over the last 70 years, or the influence of people like Tristano, is up for debate. However, it's an important fact to make note of. Tristano's legacy in music also seems to be largely debatable, as many of our most famous of jazz musicians of the day had mixed opinions. Charlie Parker praised him, Art Blakey dissed him, Miles at times did both, but it seems undeniable that he had a major influence on cool jazz and the jazz world as a whole. Thank you.